driven back to London. We don't know what happened after that. I mean, he stayed up all night, and then the next day, the houseman called me and said that he was still in his room and he was concerned that there was no sign of life.
It was Sunday, August the 27th, 1967. I switched the television on and it was announced that he was dead. And I cried, like other people that I knew that cried.
My feeling is that he would wake up in the middle of the night and think, why am I not sleeping? I haven't had my sleeping pill, in a drowsy state, so it'd take a couple more. Since then, of course, it's become legendary and there's millions of rumors. Like, did he kill himself? Did he kill himself? Who did this and that?
He certainly was in a very positive state of mind. He had made plans for the future. I'd spoken to him 2 days before, and he was anything but suicidal.
But he was just a beautiful fella, you know, and it's terrible.
What are your plans now?
Well, we haven't made any. I mean, we only just heard, haven't we?
Yes, it's, you know, it's...
Immense charm. Immense. And he actually, his strongest card, say you're measuring him up against somebody like Robert Stigwood or Andrew Oldham, Brian Epstein's strongest card is that he actually cared for the community he served, which was us, which was this group of young, artistic, free spirits, ranging from Mick Jagger to John Lennon to Joe Orton, to Edward Bond, to Bill Gaskell, to everywhere you could possibly go. Andy Warhol, Jim Dine, everybody was all connected. And somebody like Robert Fraser was doing in the art world, Brian was going to be the synthesizing force with the help of the Beatles, of course. He needed them.
We totally believed in him, thought he was a great man. I don't think we ever questioned his judgment. His judgment was very sound. If anyone was the fifth Beatle, it was Brian, you know.
I was pretty close to Brian because if somebody's going to manage me, I want to know them, you know, inside out. And the period when he told me he was a fag and all that, I introduced him to pills, you know, which... gives me a guilt association for his death, and to make him talk, you know, to find out what he's like.
Epstein was the power behind the Beatles, Jerry and the Pacemakers, Billy J. Kramer and Cilla Black. The man who redefined the role of manager was born into the comfortable middle-class Jewish community of Liverpool, after London, the oldest Jewish community in Britain. Although he came from a loving home, he described himself as a misfit. One of those out-of-sorts boys who are ragged, nagged, and bullied, and who are beloved of neither boys nor masters. He received his education in no less than 9 schools. He was happy at none of them.
The family expected Brian, I imagine, to go into the business
follow on to his father's footsteps, as Harry had done, that wasn't to be at first, because Brown was not interested in that sort of thing. He would have liked to have been a dress designer. And I think that I didn't even know this at the time. I found this out much later, because I think that Harry and Queenie must have gone out the poll. This wasn't their scene at all.
When it came to his son's ambitions, Epstein's father, Harry, drew the line at dress designing. After his disastrous school career, the young Brian went into the family business. He overcame his initial reluctance and found an outlet for his artistic aspirations in an enthusiasm for the design of furniture and the way it should be displayed. Epstein's burgeoning career in retail was rudely interrupted when he received his call-up papers for the army. He fared no better as a soldier than he had as a schoolboy. After a disastrous stint in the infantry and several psychiatric reports later, the army concluded that Epstein was a compulsive civilian, and he returned to Liverpool once again to take up his duties in the family firm.
I don't think he had a clue who he was. Now, I don't think he liked being who he was, but I think he had every intention of altering that. I think he was going to recreate, like he created the Beatles. I think he also had plans for himself.
Epstein's interest in furniture retail soon began to wane. He was drawn to Liverpool's thriving playhouse, and he became friendly with the actors and developed a fantasy that he could be an actor himself. With their help, he successfully applied to RADA, the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art, Britain's most prestigious drama school. However, he was to fare no better as a drama student than he had in the army or at school. To his bitter disappointment, he failed to stay the course and left at the end of the first year. Shamefully, he again returned to the family business. His parents' misgivings about his theatrical ambitions were confirmed. As much in exasperation as encouragement, Harry Epstein, responding to his son's interest in classical music, opened a record department in his new store in the centre of Liverpool and put Brian in charge.
Volare. Oh, oh. E canzare.
Once again, Brian rose above his shame and committed himself to his new role. The Epstein record shop became the most successful in the Northwest. He prided himself on being able to supply any customer with any record they asked for. Although his own taste was for highbrow music, he demonstrated an unlikely flair for knowing the potential hit when he heard one.
When the mists are rising and the rain is falling and the wind is blowing cold across the moor, I hear the voice of my darling, the girl I love and lost to you.
Brian said, do you ever watch a program called Compact, which is about a magazine? Because he said, I've got this press blurb here, and there's a guy called John Layton. He's going to be singing this song. So I heard it, and I thought it was absolutely diabolical, right? And I said, forget it. I said, one copy in each shop, that's all. So he said, put it on, I'd like to hear it. And Brian just stood there. And he said, right, we'll have, let me see, 250, 300. And I just looked at him and I said, Brian, you're joking. And of course it roared away, and we were the only shop in the Northwest to have copies of it.
Remember me.
And my initial impression was it was just a shop we went into to gaze and admire all the beautiful record covers and occasionally to buy a record. NEM stood for North End Music Stores, and Brian's dad, who was Harry, had once sold a piano to my dad, which I still have, so there was like a family connection before I even knew it. So for people who like to think things are fated, there we are, you know, it was even before I knew him.
Got myself a crying talking.
Saturday afternoon, it would be packed, and we had turntables behind the counter where we would play records, and there were a row of booths. All the kids used to come in, and Brian used to tolerate this. A lot of them never bought anything.
Why she satisfies my soul. Got the one and only one.
And this is where all the classical stock was kept, in long racks. And downstairs here, which we can't go down now, but it's down there in Brian's old office, which he had an office on the top floor, but he had his own office, obviously, for running the shop, where we actually signed the first contract with the Beatles. And we had two windows, of course, so Brian's great, great secret was to, he didn't just put new records into, he made displays up. There'd be cocktail glasses and a chair. He created a picture. He'd make it like a theatrical set.
For the first time, Epstein had found success. The record department of NEM Stores had become a haven for the new rock and roll generation. On a Saturday afternoon, teenagers flocked to his shop to hear not only the new releases from America by Elvis Presley, Little Richard, or Jerry Lee Lewis, but also the occasional recording by a homegrown band doing their best to imitate their American idols. He always said his life was changed when a young man in jeans and a leather jacket came in and asked for a record by a Liverpool group he'd never heard of. Legend has it that the boy's name was Raymond Jones.
Now, this is still one of those myths. What in fact happened was that I got fed up with people, youngsters coming asking for the Beatles record. It was called My Bonnie by Tony Sheridan and the Beat Brothers. And so I put a name, Raymond Jones, in the order book. And we had to order 25, the minimum. We had to import it from Germany. Bingo. And Brian, I bought one to cover Raymond Jones. And so Brian did a handwritten notice in the window, and it said, Beatles record available here. And within an hour or so, it had sold out. All the rest, the other 24 had gone. So Brian says, let's go and have lunch, but we'll drop in the cavern and see this band. And in fact, we've been accused that we surely must have known they were from Liverpool. Well, we didn't. We weren't interested in pop music. It was only later that we suddenly thought, we've seen them before in the shop. This is Matthew Street. It's amazing. It's full of Beatles, John Lennon bar, Beatles shop, Cavern pub. The one thing that isn't here, ironically, is the original cavern. It's gone. This is where it was, and where Brian and I walked down the steps those fateful day, November the 9th, 1961.
Just 250 yards from his store, Epstein chanced upon a world of which he was completely unaware, the lunchtime session at the cavern. He was enchanted by what he saw and invited the band to a meeting at the shop on a Sunday afternoon in December 1961.
I hadn't had anything to do with pop. management of pop artists before that day that I went down to the Cavern Club and heard the Beatles playing. And this was quite a new world, really, for me. I was amazed by this sort of dark, smoky, dank atmosphere, this beat music playing away. And the Beatles were then just four lads on that rather dimly lit stage, somewhat ill-clad, and the presentation was, well, left a little to be desired as far as I was concerned, because I've been interested in the theatre and acting for a long time. But amongst all that, something tremendous came over, and I was immediately struck by their music, their beat, and their sense of humour, actually, on stage. And even afterwards, when I met them, I was struck again by their personal charm.
My dad at the time, when he heard about it, he said, this could be a very good thing. He said, he thought Jewish people were very good with money. This was the kind of common wisdom. So he thought Brian would be very good for us. He thought he was very sensible, very charming, and he was right.
So we went back to Germany, we had a bit more money the second time. So we bought leather pants and we looked like four Gene Vincents, only a bit younger, I think. And that was it, you know, and we just kept the leather gear till Brian came along.
It was a bit sort of old hat anyway, all wearing leather gear. And we decided we didn't want to look sort of ridiculous just going on, because it, more often than not, sort of people, too many people would laugh. It was just stupid, we didn't want to appear as a gang of idiots. And Brian suggested that we just sort of wore ordinary suits. So we just got what we thought were quite good suits and just got rid of the leather gear.
Harry would come in, Brian's father, would come into the shop, you know, and I daren't tell him, because sometimes Brian would say, don't tell Daddy. He always called them Mummy and Daddy. Don't tell Daddy if he comes in the shop. Don't tell him where I've gone. And he'd be down in London. And I used to think of all sorts of excuses and where Brian was. And he was late back from lunch, or got another business meeting somewhere. And Harry wasn't silly. He began to cotton on that Brian was away a bit too often.
John and I used to wait at Lime Street Station in a little coffee bar called the Punch and Judy. We used to wait for Brian arriving back from London, and he'd come off the train and we'd sort of take a look at his face, you know, to see if it was like good news or bad. It was always bad.
They did old rock and roll standards, some of their own stuff, which wasn't very good. Love Me Do was the best. And things like Your Feet's Too Big, Fats Waller. And so they had an enormous repertoire of stuff. I was quite impressed with his devotion and his zeal for this group, which made me want to see them. I hadn't got a great deal to lose. And of course, when I met them and saw them and worked with them, I got the same kind of feeling that he'd got. It was a kind of falling in love business, kind of, with the, because they had this tremendous charisma, which nobody else seemed to recognize, and I was puzzled by it. But there we are. I signed them. I think the contract, it was in June 1962. I met Brian in January, but the boys were in Hamburg. And it was quite a while before we actually got together. But I did it, I had a contract prepared, and I signed it on the spot almost.
It took about 8 months to get to the stage where we had a recording contract and we were having the first record issued. And from there to the present, well, where their last record sold 500,000 copies within 10 days of issue. Actually, their first record did very well. It sold 100,000 copies. That was Love Me Do. in Liverpool, he was living at home. There was a point, I think just before the Beatle explosion, where he got himself a small apartment in the center of Liverpool, not far from me. And I know for sure that it was never a place where he was thinking of living. It wasn't a problem because it wasn't furnished. Like, I mean, if Brian was going to live there, he would have furnished just as a hundred job on it, and he never did do that. And very soon, I think, after he got it, then, of course, John Lennon married Cynthia, and she had, or was pregnant, or had Julian, and he gave it to them to live in.
Sim was having a baby, and the holiday was planned, but I wasn't going to break the holiday for a baby, you know, that's how, what a bastard I was. And I just went on holiday, you know, and I watched Brian with picking up the boys, you know.
We see, we were just Liverpool guys, so the word was queer, not gay. And it wasn't, we didn't really have a problem with it. It was just something you made fun of. That's the way it was. You know, we didn't actually know any. Well, we probably did, but we didn't talk about it. The word was out that Brian was gay amongst people, you know. The great thing for us was it didn't really affect us in any way. I think we suspected that he might hit on one of us. So I think we were kind of, in the early days, we were slightly sort of wondering whether that was his interest in us. But in my personal knowledge, he didn't. I don't actually know the truth of the John rumor. I mean, all I can ever say about that is I slept with John a lot, just because you had to sleep, and you know, you didn't have more, you know, more than one bed. And to my knowledge, John was never gay. It might have been, I suspected that the John thing and Brian was a power play on John, because John was a very political animal. And John, I suspect, went away on that Spanish holiday or wherever it was. Number one, because nobody went on holiday. So anyone would have gone. Off a free holiday, you kidding? Yes, I'm there. Number two, I'm sure John took Brian aside and said, hey, you want to deal with this group? I'm the guy you deal with, okay? John was that kind of guy, very sensible, very pragmatic. So I'm sure that was the main reason John went there. Now, as to whether there was any sort of gay dalliance or whatever, I don't know. I can't tell you that. But I know that Brian was very straightforward with me about it. We could talk about it quite openly, particularly obviously once we got to know each other. And I say, he never hit on me at all. You know, there was never any question of it at all. And I say, we lived so intimately together that there would have been one evening when he's sort of drunk and so on, so on, so on. So it would have been in his character to do that.
We didn't have an affair. Not an affair.
what is that?
See,
pressure from Brian.
I like playing a bit faggy, you know, and all that, but it's enjoyable. But there was big rumours in Liverpool, it was terrible. Very embarrassing. Oh, fuck, no, it's yes, yes.
The amphetamine time started around that time. He was introduced to these amphetamines by the Beatles and other groups. I'm sure some of Brian's initial reasons for taking the amphetamines was to be part of the little group, I mean, part of the Beatles. I mean, to be cool, to keep up with them, to show that he was cool and, you know, hip. And also, it did help. I mean, he was under pressure, and these stimulants did work. I mean, the amphetamines would keep you up late, and then, of course, you'd take sleeping pills to sleep, and then you'd wake up feeling pretty rotten as a result of the hangover from the sleeping pills, and that would start the whole cycle off, and then you'd kind of, it was a horrendous cycle.
Artists credit him with a unique judgment of what will be a hit and who will make it. Nearly all of them earn more than the Prime Minister. Can I talk to you about Brian Epstein?
Oh, certainly, yes.
What's he mean to you as
Brian?
Manager?
Oh, the money. No, seriously, he's done a lot for us, you know. He tells all kinds what to do and Yeah, made us wear suits and everything. Yeah, looked better and everything. But even in our private life, she plays a hell of a lot. Yeah, does lots of things.
Well, what other things, apart from telling you what suits to wear and how to cut your hair, that kind of thing?
Well, but sorts of little things, you know, if you have any money troubles or anything, got anything to do with money, you can always go to Brian and ask him what to do or what not to do with, and he'll always tell you, you know, as a pal.
So when Brian said to us, you know, I've got a record deal for the Beatles, maybe I can get you on, we thought, oh, he's crazy. But okay, let's make a record. At least we can tell our kids we made a record. And maybe that record can get us a few more quid, a few more jobs. Never thinking for one second that we will become famous, if that's the word you want to say, or that the Beatles will become the biggest thing since sliced bread. It was just Brian's great charisma. A foresight that could see what was going to happen. We didn't know, the Beatles didn't even know. Nor did London. London didn't know about Liverpool. They didn't know what was going to happen.
Say the words I love to hear. I'm in love with you. Oh, I've known the secret for a week or two. Nobody knows, just we two.
We arranged all our travel for us. They arranged our hotels. You know, just about everything, you know, and it was amazing because no matter where we were in the world, you know, Brian always made sure that we were taken care of financially. There would be like this registered envelope that would arrive every Saturday morning with a cash float, and we would all each have a check for the balance of what we'd earned to be sent to our accountants.
Billy J. Kramer is another from the stable who gets a frenzied welcome from his partner. Epstein says Kramer's good looks will take him to the top. As no one listened to the song, this is obviously important. The screams came in proportion to the antics.
He'd come and see a show and he would critique it, and he would really rip it apart then. You know, I used to see different members of his stable on Jukebox Jury, and the Beatles would be on, and Cilla Black would be on, and Jerry Marsden would be on, I would ask Brian, I'd say, why can't I do Jukebox Jury? And he says, because you don't speak well enough. You know, he says your diction and the way you speak is terrible, and you need to have elocution lessons.
He tried to stop us talking like that. All right, Dale, how great to see you. He said, Jerry, nobody will understand what you're saying. So we had to try and change and be a bit more cosmopolitan in our accent, which I think we did.
I was sitting in my office one day, and I got a call from a man named Brian Epstein, my secretary told me. I didn't know who he was. I picked up the phone, and he said, Mr. Livingston, we don't understand why you won't put out the Beatles records. He said, have you heard them? And I said, no. He said, would you please listen and call me back? So I said, sure. Columbia Records, RCA, then RCA Victor Records, Tedeca Records in those days, a very big company, A&M Records, every one of them turned them down. They finally got a small company in Philadelphia called Swan Records, who put out two records, and nothing happened, and Swan gave them up, said we don't want them anymore. And that was the end of it. And the Beatles could have been dead in the United States.
By 1963, no British artist had ever consistently succeeded in the American charts. Epstein was determined to change that. After the conquest of America, Epstein wrote a memoir.
Brian was a man of many moods. I mean, you, as many people have met him, if you interview each of them, they're going to come away with, you'll get another impression of a very multifaceted person.
Hello. Well, although your clock at home may show a few seconds after 1 o'clock, Grandstand, in fact, begins some 6 hours earlier, because as I talk to you now, the time is just after 7 o'clock, and I'm speaking from the observation platform at London Airport.
By February 1964, Brian Epstein had steered the Beatles to unprecedented glory on both sides of the Atlantic. Back home, Epstein's Stable of Stars had occupied the top position in the charts for 37 weeks in 1963. In little over a year, Epstein had gone from running a record department in his father's store to becoming one of the most successful impresarios in the world. When he returned with the Beatles to Britain in triumph, he was still living at home with his parents in Liverpool.
The music the crowd sings is the music that Liverpool has sent echoing around the world.
A Mersey sound, this phrase I gather you don't like, was, of course, coined presumably by newspaper men because of the crop of groups coming from the Liverpool area.
I found it a peg to hang the thing on.
The Liverpool area seemed to give the movement some sort of strength, but you yourself have now just moved down to London. Isn't this a mistake?
Yes. It's a pity. I've moved with great reluctance, actually, because I like Liverpool and I like its people, and obviously I probably owe the city quite a lot.
How much do you get of the Beatles? What's your percentage?
Well, it's fairly well known in broad terms that I take 25%.
Some people you know accuse you of perhaps taking a lot more than that. I mean, there were rumors fly around. People say you might have as much as 60% of them and 85% of your other artists.
Yes, well, I don't. I make no difference between any of the artists. All my artists have similar contracts to each other.
Little children, you better tell on me.
Epstein achieved unprecedented success while he was still living in Liverpool. However, inevitably, he moved his operation to London at the beginning of 1964. He found offices next to the world-famous Palladium, He said he wanted his next door neighbors to be the greatest entertainers on earth.
Like you ought to be, and keep the secret with me. I wish they would go away, little children. Now why ain't you playing outside? I'm asking you.
Do you think you could have got to the top without Brian Epstein?
No, I don't think so. Well, at the time, nobody wanted to know anything about Liverpoolians until Brian Epstein came on the scene. I mean, it was a bit of an handicap to anybody who did come from Liverpool because of the way they spoke.
How's it changed you?
I think you'd have to ask my parents and people who know me, because I can't see any change. But I know one thing, I'm more temperamental now.
I think that he wanted somewhere which was one of the more exclusive residential areas. You know, he was newly rich, and at the time, Brian was very, very into modern architecture and modern furniture, and this suited perfectly because it was a brand new building and considered rather splendid in those days of the early 60s. Now, I think, I looked at it recently, it doesn't look too splendid at all. George and Ringo, who were bachelors and had nowhere to live, he found accommodations for them in the same building on the lower floor. They would look to Brian to help them find somewhere, and this is what he found.
He has enormous respect for them. They're always called the boys. And the other people he looks after are called my other artists. And the boys call him Effie. And he seems to have a genuine respect for them and their music, unlike a lot of managers in this business who make a lot of money out of the people they look after. And I think at Rock Bottom despise them.
What about taste and things like that? Is he interested in that? The effect he's having in this worldwide mania?
I think it's very difficult for him to affect the Beatles as far as taste goes. I think they admire him because clearly he's got some. They rather like the fact he has a Bentley and a Jaguar and a coloured manservant. They like the sort of riches and the glamour that his life seems to have. And they also like the fact that he talks differently from the way they do. And the fact that he's quite well off anyway. They like this. They like the fact he's used to wearing a dinner jacket. And they think he's different, a sort of cut above.
He always sort of had a white shirt and a dark suit and black shoes, always black shoes. Every day, come rain or shine, breakfast consisted of the same thing, grapefruit and tea, grapefruit and tea, until the cows came home. Said I was his personal man. But I mean, he wasn't. He never had anybody as a servant for himself. He was learning, because we hear that Epstein came from this well-to-do family. But if you looked at his apartment during the day, it was all G-plan.
Let's go to Honolulu, London, and Mr. Brian Epstein.
Gauguin from London Hullabaloo. This week, I have the great pleasure to introduce a very beautiful young girl who's only recently made a name for herself, Marianne Faithfull.
I know we looked at them as being very provincial, very straight. You know, sort of a little bit behind London people. Which is very patronizing and not really true. Brian sort of crossed the line. He was quite a lot in the grown-up world, but also able to play with us. I think that what Brian Epstein realized was that we were almost a new form. In some ways, the actual artists, and I consider myself one of them, there wasn't much that had gone before that was quite like me, or John Lennon, or Mick Jagger. The only person who was like Mick, I felt that, and I remember talking about that with Brian, was somebody like Nijinsky, or Nuriel. Or Valentino, maybe. But still, it was a not much understood form yet. But Brian understood all that. He was a grown-up, and we needed somebody. We needed a few people like that.
How long is it since you first made the first record of Tears Go By?
About 6 months ago.
What was the story behind it? You know, how did it all start?
I met Andrew Oldham at a party. He asked me if I'd like to make a record because he thought I had a face that could sell.
And what did you think?
I thought, this is fine. Perhaps I have. Let's sell it.
Had you sung before?
No, just
not at all?
He was going on a hunch and an idea, and he was very afraid always of being shot down in flames, of being unmasked. And if you think about the period of England at this time and being gay, and being powerful, and being rich, and having a vision, it was all quite a combustible and dangerous mix that could go up in flames any minute.
But amid all the gaiety and glamour, how ruthless does Epstein find the business underneath?
How ruthless do you think you've got to be? Not very. It may even be a fault of mine in the business that I'm not ruthless enough.
Do you feel that you exploit teenage talent?
No. Talent? No. You can... I think I develop teenage talent rather than exploit it.
Life goes on day after day. Hearts torn in every way. So West of Mersey, 'cause this land's the place I love, and here I'll stay.
Are you ever timid about going into new areas, highly technical areas like this, without a great deal of knowledge or experience?
Not really, because one studies quite a lot from an outsider's point of view, and after all, I'd started to manage the Beatles and the others without any experience at all.
So ferry, cross the Mersey, and always take me there.
We were in New York, and Bob Dylan came around to visit with a couple of other people, a guy called Al Aronowitz, who was a friend of his and his road manager. I think they were the people who had the part, actually. You know, Bob kind of gets blamed for it. I'm not sure he's too happy with that rap. That night, anyway, was the first time I think all of us had smoked pot. George and I were sitting on this bed, and Brian was sort of lying there rather grandly, as he would. He was very grand. Brian's greatest, This was Brian's expression. What do you think of it? Everything was, So, you knew exactly what he meant. And so he's lying on the bed, very sort of grand, you know, beautifully dressed and everything. And got this image of him with a tiny little bit of a butt, like an old tramp, you know, go
trying to be graceful with this terrible little fag end. And actually, we all got stoned, and we're giggling. It was giggling times. We were giggling uncontrollably. And Brian was looking at himself. He's going, Jew. They were hysterical.
You wouldn't read my letter if I wrote you. You asked me not to call you on the phone.
The kind of thing would happen was we would go to a late night drinking club. There were often all men there. I don't think any of us went, ooh, there's all men there. It was just, did that happen to be the sort of, you know, the nature of the club kind of thing?
There was a bar called Kelly's Bar on 45th Street between 6th Avenue and Broadway, which originally was very famous as a serviceman's bar. And then it was just across the street from Kelly's. It was called the Peppermint Lounge. Then there was another country western place called the Wagon Wheel, right across the street. And we used to go there. That was a rough and wild place, and Brian liked that too. And Brian was always attracted to a very sort of crass, macho person, sort of a hard hat construction worker type.
I didn't know God made honky-tonk angels. Never make a wife. You gave up the only one that ever loved you and went back to the wild side of life.
He told me about the fact that he's having to move his business to London. But he had to expand a great deal. It was a great deal of work for him to do. He didn't like office work at all. And he did like to have around him people that he knew. He said that there were a number of people, lots of people in London, who would love to come and work for the management of the Beatles. But he was very leery of a lot of people's motives in this respect. So I agreed that I would come and work for him. I knew nothing about pop music, the music business, the entertainment business. I didn't like pop music. By the time I joined NEMS, there were a number of outstanding problems, matters, concerns. One of the most difficult items was that concerning the merchandising of Beatles-related objects, wigs, pens, guitars, heaven knows what. And it transpired, I found out, that manufacturers had approached Brian and asked him for the rights to manufacture and sell Beatles-related objects. The deal which they had done with Brian was for them to do the licensing, collect the income, and pay NEMS for the account of the Beatles 10% of the proceeds. Looking at it now, and indeed looking at it then, this was an extraordinary deal. It should have been the other way around. The Beatles should have got 90%, and the licensors, who in fact no more than agents, should have got a small agency commission. Brian was beginning to realize that it was a bad deal, that he was only getting 10% for the account of the Beatles, from all these enormous payments being made principally in America. The effect of this unhappy experience on Brian was to depress him very considerably.
To give him his due, though, Brian and us would not know about those kind of things. British people at that time didn't know about that stuff. I'm not so sure how much they know about it now, but I think the problems arose in as much as he was from Liverpool. He hadn't done this before. He had the great theatricality, but he hadn't done this kind of business before. So I think some of the deals that he got us were great for the time, but not as it turned out. You know, I can look back on it now and say he could have done that, he could have asked for that. But I just don't think any of us knew about that then. It was very early days, you know.
We were making it up as we went along. I mean, almost everything we did, what Brian did in business, what we did in our social lives, what, how we handled ourselves, and how, was all, we did it as we went along. Brian and I would be in the office during the day, and he had the NEMS company to run. And at night, you know, we'd have dinner and then go to the clubs. You couldn't go just anywhere because they'd be mobbed. They were very small, incredibly small. The first one I remember was the Ad Lib. Then there was the Scotch. Later there was the Cromwellian. And they were very, very exclusive. I mean, you know, you had to be a Rolling Stone or a Beatle or some such person.
It was best to get there around midnight. If you were one of the chosen few, you'd be quickly let inside to play your part in the cast of Gossip Column Fantasyland. Business rumours abounded in the Scotch. Talk of fiddles and rip-offs and coups against record companies. We learnt just how little Brian Epstein had got from EMI for the Beatles, how a famous manager had been hung from his office window by his feet for chatting up someone else's group. We found out who was on the verge of bankruptcy and who'd given whom the clap. You had to, as a manager, you had to aspire to be what Brian was, to be the manager of the biggest, most enormous success ever in history. And there was a sort of innate jealousy of not being as big as he was, or not having experienced what he had. And therefore, to have dinner with him and get secondhand, at least, from him the experience and all the things you'd ever wanted to ask. I would imagine everybody wanted to ask this, everyone in the country. I mean, they'd either want to ask what it was like being a Beatle, or what it was like being a Beatles manager.
Do you ever envy the Beatles?
No, no.
What don't you envy about them, then?
Well, I couldn't do what, obviously, I couldn't do what they do. It's not my job.
A lot of stress has been laid on being gay or fancying John Lennon or somebody else, but I think it was far more just being a loner and suddenly finding he was part of a group. And I think that was much more what he was interested in. And in some way, that brought him into a broader group again, rather than the Beatles, just show business. But what he wanted was to feel he was one of them. And that's what he could never have. He told me that just once he allowed himself to go and stand at the back with all the girls in a concert in America, I think, in the stadiums. And he screamed just with the girls and just like one of the girls, which he said is what he'd always wanted to do from the first minute he'd ever seen them. And he spent his whole life being restrained and still wearing suits and ties, and suddenly he just screamed and became the mad fan he wanted to be.
I thought he was a very nice, sweet man who was very lonely. And he was lonely because he couldn't find a partner. The only partners he could find were the ones that he had to pick up. He had two affairs that I knew of. One was an actor called Michael, and it was absolutely wonderful then. And then he had this lover boy that he picked up in California and brought back from their second tour of America. This was Diz Gillespie. Diz looked a bit like Gene Pitney, clean-cut sort of young man. And as far as I was concerned, it was a nice time because Epstein was playing house.
All the time that I knew him, I don't think that one could ever say that he had any long-term emotional relationship. I mean, I think partly it could have been he wasn't comfortable about the fact that he was gay, and therefore, I suppose, in a way, that led to a situation where you didn't have a successful homosexual relationship and the inability to have one because it was not your ideal way or your underlying way of living your life, or subconsciously, though it may have been. And I don't think that was unusual for the time.
One evening, he wanted me to cook dinner for his mother and father, and he and Diz were there, so I went out and did the usual thing, grapefruit, large Dover soles, veg, and a simple pudding. And we were halfway through the meal when Diz stood up and said something nasty to Epstein and walked under the flat. Whereupon Queenie and Harry were sitting there dumbfounded, not knowing what to do. Then Epstein left the flat, leaving me and Harry and Queenie there. And they decided to get their coats because there wasn't going to be a complete meal that evening. And as they got ready to leave the flat, Queenie said to me, "Lonnie, look after my son."
The office. As I passed his bedroom on the way up, there was often notes left for me from under the door, and they could be anything from "Wake me at 3 o'clock with breakfast," "Dropped," 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They could be some money in an envelope, "Please bank my happiness, last night's happiness," as he may have gone to the Claremont or the White Elephant and done some gambling. So downstairs, right downstairs, was the staff quarters. This was where his housekeeper and her husband lived. He went upstairs to the sitting room, and behind the sitting room was Brian's study where he worked. The second floor was his suite of, was the bedroom. You went in through his dressing room, double doors to his dressing room, and then into his bedroom, and then through there to his bathroom. The bathroom was pretty unique. It was totally white, with a huge whole one wall, with El Cordobez on one wall. It was very imposing. And then the rest of the top floor was two rooms knocked into one, and that was where I worked, in one corner. It was the office by day and the playroom by night. It was where he had all his memorabilia and his presents from Elvis, the turn given him. It was just full of treasures of Brian's. It was also where everybody went up at night to play. And at the weekend, I used to put my typewriter under my desk, because then it wasn't the office anymore.
I would always see Brian on important occasions, you know, like if it was ever my birthday, he would always show up, you know, and he'd always show up with a gift and take me out to dinner. So when you say, did he change? I don't think so. I think a lot of people may have changed towards him. You know, I mean, let's face it. He had a very difficult life when you think about it. You know, people say, oh, well, he was making all that money, but I mean, there was a lot of pressure involved there. And he was in charge of a lot of people.
I would get annoyed with Brian because he spent so much time with the Beatles, more than he did with us. And that was some of my arguments. I'd say, Brian, how come you've gone a week with the Beatles, we haven't seen you, you come one day with me? And he would say, Jerry, please, you realize these four guys are the biggest in the world. They're stars. You're a little light bulb. I used to get jealous, but I realized in the end, Brian was correct. He had to spend more time with the Beats.
As time went by, there were so many acts they could never get the attention that was warranted from Brian. And of course, every act that went to NEMS expected to be treated like the Beatles. And consequently, there was a string of acts that just didn't happen.
Brian was very ambitious for his business, and he wanted to diversify a great deal. Hence his acquisition of the Savile Theatre, which we'd all had high hopes for initially. A number of the artists whom he had then were not very successful either. All these, of course, were counterbalanced by the continuing fantastic success of the Beatles and Cilla Black and Jerry and the Pacemakers, who continued to be very high earners and very, very popular performers indeed.
He may not have been the greatest businessman in the world. He may well have made a lot of mistakes. I know he did, or probably he did. Not that I care. I couldn't care less about things like licensing T-shirt deals. You know, it just isn't interesting. And I don't think it's so bad to not be good at that sort of thing. But he obviously wasn't very good at that. So you could pick endless holes in Brian Epstein if you wanted to. And he, to me, had a sort of golden, I could see that he had this golden future, which wasn't necessarily going to be just managing the Beatles and Zilla. He was in a tradition, a sort of English impresario tradition. I can't remember all the names, but does the name Binky Beaumont come to mind here? Yes, it does, doesn't it? And all those kind of guys. That's where he fits into the Noel Gar genre. He really was in that sort of great actor-manager tradition, actually. And his greatest moment, for me, was the Savile Theatre. It didn't last very long, and everybody's forgotten about it.
Were you any good as an actor?
Not at the time. I like to think that I may have been.
Has it left you with a distaste for, or a real taste for, theatre?
A real taste for theatre.
Real theatre?
Yes, very much so. I would like so much to produce and, dare I say it, act in a play, a
what,
straight play.
What sort of plays?
Possibly something by Chekhov or a modern straight drama.
What sort of drama is it?
Osborne, something that one knows about.
This managing it, managing the artist, what does a manager do for the artist? Let's assume the Beatles, four bright boys, one is told.
Yes.
Why couldn't they cope with these sort of things themselves?
Well, they wouldn't be bothered to do so anyway, as they are at present.
Could they have got themselves to where they are now without...
No, I don't think they would have bothered. They were playing around the clubs in Liverpool and having great fun. But I don't think that they would have bothered to do anything about it, and they may not have done it in the right way, because there's so much work involved in what we call the management, one could say the organization of the Beatles, that they couldn't possibly do it for themselves.
Do they need you as a manager, or have they got to a stage now where anybody could manage them who knew the technical side of the thing?
I don't think that anybody could manage them, because I don't think that the Beatles would be managed by anyone else.
Is it this personal relationship?
I don't know whether I should be saying that, actually, but I think that it's true.
That was the beginning of the horrendous tours of 1966. That was us arriving at Munich Airport, Germany, in June, I think it was, of 1966. Everything had become very, very difficult. There'd been Germany, which we'd done on the train, which hadn't been easy. It was all that kind of business of, hiding away in rooms with sealed doors with wet towels, so nobody could smell the marijuana being smoked. Then we went to Japan, which, where there was an attempt on their lives, and this right-wing group in Japan threatened to, promised that they would be assassinated during this period of time. This was immediately followed by when we went to the Philippines, where the awful Mrs. Marcos had invited us to lunch, and it was Brian's policy not to go to official functions. She turned the situation around as it was a slap in the face to the Philippine people. There was a very serious riot at the airport, and I think our lives were in danger.
It was very bad. There was about five sort of real big sort of
funny looking fellas with guns and all the rest of the gear.
Who did all the kicking?
Yeah, and you know, they just had arranged, you know, it was so obvious they'd arranged to give us the worst time possible, you know, before we arrived at the airport.
Brian literally was so ill with nerves and horror and feeling it was all his fault. And then subsequently on the plane from Delhi to London, he came out in hives all over his skin. So bad that the pilot radioed ahead in an ambulance matters at the airport.
We're wondering whether you're going to change the itinerary of the Beatles to avoid areas where radio stations are now burning their records and their pictures.
Actually, if any of the promoters were so concerned and it was their wish that a concert should be cancelled, I wouldn't in fact stand in their way.
But the Beatles made a statement in all the newspapers that they're getting more better than Jesus himself, and the Ku Klux Klan, being a religious order, is going to come out here the night that they appear at the Coliseum here. I shall have about 50 men in robes, and I'll have quite a few inside the stadium.
We'd had enough of it with the trouble we were running into. I finally agreed with the other guys, because it took me a little while to come round. I thought we'd tour forever. But I started to realize, yeah, it was going to be a problem.
Brian said this will be the last time, I'll never forget that, he said this will be the last time the Beatles will ever perform together. So, they will never tour again. We didn't go to the last concert. On that day, this showed up miraculously. This is after 2 years. Brian assured me, I mean, that he changed and that, you know, he's really there because he loves Brian. That evening, when I went to get my briefcase, it was gone, and so was Brian's briefcase, and so was this gone. That depressed Brian. That accounts for his first major depression. I mean, that was the beginning of him, of his loss of self-confidence. Starting that January of 67, Brian began to go downhill. And that was the era that, that was the acid era.
He was taking so many drugs, I mean, amphetamines, which really fuck you up, I mean, up and down, and leave you deeply depressed, and then you take uppers and so forth. So the combination of the amphetamines, the LSD, the hash, who knew what in fact was causing what?
We are very happy to welcome Brian Epstein of England to WOIFM and our microphones. Brian, it's a delight to have you on the show.
Welcome to America.
And all that kind of jazz.
Yeah. All right.
The year's difference, while it has been great in many fields, how has it changed as far as your own thinking, your own direction? Has there been a change for you?
Well, it's changed because when I first came over here with Billy Kramer, I only knew two people in New York. Really, it was beyond everything there, because I didn't know what was going on. One acted sensibly, with common sense, as much as anything else. But the success with the records was so unbelievable, and the acceptance of the boys was so great that one didn't quite know what was going on. I sold records over a counter in the Liverpool store for a long time, 6 years, I think. And it was only that I was getting bored with doing that, because I could almost anticipate demand, that I went away for a little while, to Spain actually, and came back. And then the Beatle thing happened. But that was a long time ago, that was 1961. It took a long time to break through.
I felt that more and more he was having trouble coping. Not coping with the Beatles. The Beatles were never a problem for him to cope with. It was just the general overall pressures of life. The Beatles never got put on hold. He never didn't carry out his duties where the Beatles were concerned, because in the end, that was the love of Brian's life. That was more than anything what Brian wanted in his whole life. The Beatles were his life. I don't think that he could conceive of a life without them, and that became a big problem for him.
When we actually did finish touring, I suppose Brian felt his role was decreasing, and I think that was a sadness to him. I think that actually was what was happening. I think the problem was we were starting to feel we didn't really need much management. We are now in the studio making Sgt. Pepper. And Brian kept out, to give him, again, to his credit, he kept out of our face in the studio. In fact, we actually wanted him to visit a little more because we liked him. So he was always nice when he showed up, but he was very, no, I won't interrupt. I'm just 2 seconds, gotta go.
I'll tell you, I did worry about that man. Sometimes he would talk and chat, and he'd ask me about my kids and how lucky I was to have a family. That seemed to be one of his things. I think loneliness. For all, he's standing in the crowd, he was lonely. And of course he was shy, he's very shy. I mean, most of the blasé bit was acting. He's a very shy man. Yeah, he'd go on, talk about different things. Another time he'd be very, very morose and he wouldn't say a bloody word. Peter Brown was very worried that someone might see him and so on and so forth. Well, who the hell's going to see him that time in the morning, wrapped up in a blanket? And they pumped him out. And he was moaning and crying on the table, and I was watching them pump him out.
The drugs that were there were already quite hard to handle. You know, being on acid all the time was not the easiest way to live. But we managed.
He just wanted to change his life. He wanted to retire from the music business and actually manage bullfighters in Spain. He approached me to see if I would become joint managing director of NEMS and look after everything there except the Beatles. He gave me an option, I think it was for 6 months, if I paid him £500,000, then the controlling shares, it was 51%, because his brother and a few other people were involved, would be transferred to me and my company. I would control the company, including the Beatles.
No, there was no question in our minds that if we were to be managed, it would be by Brian. We dealt with it very quickly. He said, Robert Stigwood wants to buy you. We said, oh, yeah. He said, and we're having a meeting with him and one of his business people. And we said, oh, yeah, well, we're not very keen on this, Brian. You know that, don't you? So we waited till the meeting. And then they said, well, they're talking about the conditions. And we said, well, let's just get this straight. We're not going to be sold to anyone. If you can continue to manage us, we love you, we're not going to be sold. He said, in fact, if you do, if you somehow manage to pull this off, or someone, there's a trick here, he said, we can promise you one thing. We will record God Save the Queen for every single record we make from now on, and we'll sing it out of tune. That is a promise. So if this guy buys us, that's what he's buying.
24 Chapel Street, London, SW1, August 23rd, 1967. Dear Nat, just got yours of the 21st. Sunday and Monday, I'd quite like to take a yacht trip on similar lines to that which we took last year when I came to the States in connection with Jesus Christ. Maybe on Sunday we could have all manner of lovely, pretty mortal persons aboard. I hope I'm not asking for too many things, but I'm anxious for this to be a good trip for us both. Till the second, love, flowers, bells, be happy, and look forward to the future with love, Brian. This was the last letter that Brian had written me, which was written 3 days before he died. This is also the letter that was introduced at the inquest in London as a matter of evidence to show that Brian Epstein did not commit suicide, but that his death was accidental.
At the time of the August bank holiday in 1967, Brian invited Peter Brown and myself to stay with him at his house in Kingsley Hill in Sussex. And we joined him on the Friday evening.
His mother stayed, like a week, 10 days with him at Chapel Street. And, he adored his mother, and she adored him. And this, of course, was not long after his father had died, so that was one of the reasons why he wanted to look after and nurture her. But it certainly restricted him, and I think that after she went back, he felt like playing, and what was offered was a weekend in the country.
So about 4 o'clock that afternoon, we walked down the stairs of Chapel Street together, and he was in a very relaxed, very happy mood. He seemed very sunny, and I walked into the car, and he told me, "You have a good weekend. I hope you have a really enjoyable weekend." And I told him the same thing, and he got in the car, and just as he pulled away, he turned and he waved to me and he smiled at me, and that was the last time I saw Brian alive.
There was an idea of some young men who would come and stay for the weekend and who would be, fun to have around. They kept on saying they were coming, and then didn't come. And Brian, in his agitated state, was suddenly confronted with the fact that it is a long holiday weekend yawning ahead with no apparent entertainment arriving, and all he was stuck with was two of his oldest friends.
So Brian suddenly decided that he would go up to London.
And he went off and assured me that he was going to be all right and I should go to bed, and nobody knows for sure, I don't think, what happened that evening. I mean, he subsequently called me the next afternoon, late afternoon, in a rather woozy speech, and apologized for not coming back and for maybe letting us worry, although we knew he was in the house because I'd spoken to the staff.
He was going to stay in London for another night. He wasn't feeling terribly strong. He was relaxing at home in bed, and so Peter Brown and I were left again to our own devices in the house.
On the Sunday, I got a call from Antonio and Maria. They were a Spanish couple, and they were the housekeeper and the butler. And Antonio said that he was very concerned that Brian had come back from Kingsley Hill on Friday. His car hadn't moved since Saturday, and it was now Sunday lunchtime. And he was very concerned about Brian. When I got to Chapel Street, I had a key, let myself in, and I knocked on the door and I called out his name. I called, answer the door, are you there? And so then I went down to the kitchen and I called down to Kingsley Hill and spoke to Peter Brown. And I asked him, I said, why did Brian come back? Why is he here? He gave me some reason that Brian was bored and came back into town, and I said, well, I'm very concerned. Brian's in his room. He hasn't been out of it since Saturday. I'm going to have them break the doors down. And I hung up, and then I tried Dr. Cowan. he wasn't there, he was away. So I called Peter back and I told him, and he said, yesterday I called another doctor, Peter's doctor, John Galway. So I called John Galway and he was there, and I said that I was concerned about Brian and could he come over to the house, and he said yes, he would. I called a few other people and I couldn't find him, and I found Alistair, and I asked him to come to the house. John Galway arrived and we went up to Brian's room, and Antonio and John Galway broke the doors down, and I could just see part of Brian in the bed.
Joanne opened the door and just pointed upstairs, and as I was halfway up, I heard wood, splintering wood. I was right behind the doctor as he was looking at Brian, and Brian just looked asleep. The room was looking so normal. There was a plate of chocolate digestive biscuits on the bed, lying on the bed, some correspondence, which is typical of Brian, a half-empty or half-full bottle of bitter lemon, no sign of any alcohol around. On the bedside table, there were about 8 bottles, pill bottles, prescribed drugs, and they were all half-full. I searched the room in case there was anything incriminating, and I found one joint in a drawer.
Harry had died 6 weeks before. Queenie came to London and stayed with Brian. He was very attentive. He was, you know, very caring about his mother, about the fact that she'd lost Harry, and he very much cared about her grief and all of the rest of it. So the idea that he would kill himself 6 weeks after Harry died and that he would do that to Queenie just didn't seem possible, just didn't seem true to me. So if it was suicide, I can't imagine why he would have done that at that stage. I mean, you know, Queenie lost her son and her husband within 6 weeks.
We were in Wales with Maharishi. We'd just gone down after seeing his lecture the first night. It was a place called Bangor. I don't know, I can't remember, you know, it just sort of came over. Somebody came up to us, the press were there, because we'd gone down with this strange Indian, you know. And they said, Brian's dead. And I was stunned, you know, and we all were, I suppose. And Maharishi, we went into, what? You know, he's dead and all that, and he was sort of saying, oh, forget it, you know, be happy, fucking idiot.
I understand that this afternoon Maharishi conferred with you all. Could I ask you what advice he offered you?
He told us not to get overwhelmed by grief, and to whatever thoughts we have of Brian, to keep them happy, because any thoughts we have of him will travel to him wherever he is.
Had he ever met Mr. Epstein?
No, but he was looking forward to meeting him.
Tomorrow?
Yes.
What was your feeling when Brian died?
The feeling that anybody has when somebody close to them dies, there's a sort of little hysterical sort of hee-hee, and that it's not me or something in it, you know? And the other feeling is, you know, what the fuck, you know? What can I do, you know? I mean, I knew that we were in trouble then. I didn't really have any misconceptions about our ability to do anything other than play music. And I was scared, you know. I thought, we fucking had it now.
It was a great memory of mine, in his polka dot scarf at the back of the crowd, holding himself very proud of his boys, you know. No one else was going to stack up against Brian, in my mind. He couldn't have the flair, the panache, you know, the wit, the intelligence that Brian had. They would just merely be money managers. Brian was far more than that. So, yeah, it did give people an opportunity to come in and sort of make approaches, but they were destined not to work, any of those, because Brian was just too good.